life for you and me, and failing love. He gave himself to set us free.
Let's turn now in our Bibles to the 22nd Psalm. I'll read the first and the odd-numbered verses, and we ask you to join together as you read the even-numbered verses. Shall we stand as we read? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring?
O my God, I cry to thee, but thou hearest not, and in thy strength I seek thee.
But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. They cried unto thee and were delivered. They trusted in thee and were not confounded. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip. They shake the head, saying, Thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. My strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. I may tell all my bones, they look and stare upon me. But be not thou far from me, O Lord. O my strength, haste thee to help me. Save me from the lion's mouth, and for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him. And all ye the seed of Jacob, glorify him and fear him, all ye the seed of Israel. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all of the kindreds of the nation shall worship before thee. All they that be fat upon the earth shall eat and worship, and all they that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. And they shall come and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. Shall we pray? Father, we're so grateful that as we gather today, we can declare that you indeed have done this. You sent your only begotten Son, who was miserably treated by men, who bore our sins in his own body, who allowed himself to be humiliated and crucified that we might have life. And now, Lord, even as we have gathered this day and as we lift now our hearts to you, we pray that your Holy Spirit will minister your truth unto us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Saturday around here is going to be a fun day in that we will be offering for the children an alternative for Halloween, and we'll have all kinds of activities, all kinds of food, games, and just everything you can think of for the young people here on Saturday. If you'd like to help with the program, we'd ask you to contact the office, and there will be tickets available here on Saturday for the event, and there are flyers in the office that describe next Saturday. So Saturday becomes fun day on this next Saturday. So we encourage you to bring the children, the grandchildren, and let them have a great day together from 11 o'clock in the morning till 3 in the afternoon. We've now come to the Gospel of Mark, and as we have noted, as we've been going through Mark, that he gives us basically an abbreviated account of the life of Jesus Christ. The other Gospels give a more complete and fuller account. Mark's Gospel, he has a way of just sort of abbreviating the account of the life of Jesus. And so in the 15th chapter, as he records for us the crucifixion of Jesus, his death on the cross for us, again, Mark gives to us an abbreviated account. But we'd like to look at Mark's account of the crucifixion and compare what happened to Jesus when he was crucified with what the scriptures predicted would happen to the Messiah. As we set them side by side, we will then realize what Paul meant when he said, "The gospel that I declared unto you, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures." When Paul says according to the scriptures, he is referring to the scriptures of the Old Testament and how that the death of Jesus Christ for our sins was something that was spoken of by the prophets in the Old Testament times. The fulfillment was in Jesus, but it was prophesied long before that he would give his life for our sins. And so as we look at Mark's Gospel, chapter 15, we see in verse 3, "And the chief priest accused him of many things, but he answered nothing." In Isaiah 53:7, we read, "He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth." Now we are told here in Mark's gospel that as they were making these accusations, Jesus did not respond to the accusation, so much so that Pilate was sort of amazed, and he said, "Don't you hear all of these things they're saying against you? Don't you have any answer?" And Jesus still remained silent, so that Pilate marveled at his silence. Now, as you think through history, how many men can you think of in history who were charged with a crime that would bring the judgment of death upon them, but the charges were totally baseless and false, and yet the man did not say anything to defend his innocence, but just kept silence in the face of false accusations? Now, even when a man is guilty, he'll try to offer some kind of a defense, some kind of an excuse, some kind of a rationale for which he did his crime. But how many men do you know who were innocent and yet, being accused of a capital crime, did not respond in their own defense? I would say that if it were 1 in 1,000, and we would make that kind of a supposition, we would be extremely conservative. I would imagine it would be more like 1 in 1 billion, but let's just say, for sake of removing any argument, 1 in 1,000. In verse 15, of Mark chapter 15, "And so Pilate, willing to content the people, released Barabbas unto them and delivered Jesus when he had scourged him to be crucified." Now, the scourging was a beating across the back of a prisoner as they would lay 39 stripes upon their back with a cat of nine tail whip. It was a very torturous, painful infliction of punishment upon the prisoner, but the purpose was to elicit through pain and suffering confessions from the prisoner of crimes that he had committed against the state. Such things would be outlawed today, of course, in America. But there are countries where they still practice caning. And so, how many men do you suppose have been beaten in punishment across their back, scourged? Would you say that 1 in 1,000 would be a fair kind of an estimate? Most people don't endure that kind of suffering. I doubt if anyone here today has had that kind of an experience. Surely I haven't. So let's put it at 1 in 1,000. Actually, Isaiah chapter 50, verse 6, he said, "I gave my back to the smiters, and my cheeks to those who plucked out the hair, and I hid not my face from shame and spitting." Verse 19, Mark. "And they smote him on the head with a reed and did spit upon him. And bowing their knees, they feigned worship." We had just read in Isaiah chapter 50, verse 6, "I hid not my face from the shame and the spitting." In the Mideast and in the Orient, the worst insult that you can give to a person is to spit in their face. Here is the prophecy that they would spit in his face. And here in Mark's gospel, we find the fulfillment of that prophecy. Now, again, how many men do you suppose have gone through that kind of disgrace and all of having someone spit in their face? Now, I have never had anyone spit in my face, and I would feel sorry for anyone who tried it. I mean, I wouldn't take kindly to someone spitting in my face. And I would perhaps respond rather in a reactionary way and then repent later. But how many men do you suppose who have lived in the history of mankind who have had that kind of shame, someone spitting in their face? Would you say that 1 in 100 would be a very conservative estimate? I would think so. Verse 24, and when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them what every man should take. So the idea of casting lots, or in a sense throwing dice to discover who would get his robe. In the psalm that we read this morning, the prophecy was, they part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. Can you think of any other person that you have read about in history who was put to death by crucifixion and whose robe was gambled for? I don't know of any other man in history who has had that experience, but again, conservatively, let's say 1 in 100,000. In verse 27, we read, and with him they crucified 2 thieves, one on his right hand and the other on his left. Now, again, the thought of crucifixion. But here it says that there would be 2 thieves crucified with him. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 12. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death. That is, he was crucified. And he was numbered with the transgressors, a thief on either side. And he bore the sins of many, and he made intercession for the transgressors. That is, he prayed for the transgressors. We remember that Luke tells us that as they were nailing him to the cross, he prayed, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Actually, there are several things to consider here. Number one, that he would be put to death by, he would then be numbered with the transgressors in his death. So, how many men are put to death by capital punishment? And those that are, how many put to death with transgressors, who are men who are innocent, put to death with transgressors? Let's say 1 in 10,000. Verse 29. And they that passed by railed on him, wagging their heads. Of course, wagging is another way of saying shaking their heads. In Psalm 22:7, it says, all they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip and they shake their head, shaking and wagging. How many people have had the crowd just scorning them as they shook their heads and yelled at them, laughing them to scorn. Let's say one in a thousand. Then in Mark chapter 15, verse 31, likewise also the chief priest mocking said among themselves with the scribes, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross that we may see and believe." And then Matthew tells us that they said he trusted in God. "Let him deliver him now if he will have him, for he said, I am the Son of God." We find that the chief priest almost quoted verbatim what the psalmist prophesied in Psalm 22:7. "They that see me laugh me to scorn, they shoot out the lip, they shake their heads, saying, he trusted in the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighteth in him." Almost verbatim, Psalm 22:8. I'm certain that if we could translate directly or read it directly in the original language, you'll find that the only difference probably is in the translations between the Hebrew, Greek, and then into English. But the declaration of the priest is almost verbatim what was prophesied in Psalm 22:8. How many men do you know put to death? And the chief priest had declared, he said that, you know, he trusts in the Lord, let the Lord deliver him now, seeing he said he was the Son of God. I don't know of anybody else. And it's unlikely that there are, but let's put it 1 in 100,000. Verse 33. "And when the sixth hour was come," that is noon, you start counting at 6 o'clock in the morning, the daylight hours. So the sixth hour would be noon. "And when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour." Now we find a remarkable prophecy in Amos chapter 8, verse 9. "And it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord God, that I will cause the sun to go down at noon, and I will darken the earth in a clear day, and I will turn your feast into mourning and your songs into lamentation. And I will bring up sackcloth upon all loins and baldness upon every head. And I will make it as the mourning of an only son, and the end thereof as a bitter day." Note there were three basic stipulations in that prophecy. Number one, the sun would go down at noon, or as Mark said, on the sixth hour. It would be a feast day, and Christ was crucified on Passover, that major feast day of the Jews. And then the mourning would be as for an only son. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Now, the recorded history of man is about 6,000 years. Everything beyond that is speculation. But we have 6,000 years of recorded history. In the 6,000 years of recorded history, you would actually have about 4,290,000 days. Now, of those 4,290,000 days, how many days can you think of in history where it became dark at noontime on a clear day when it wasn't an eclipse of the sun? Now, it would be impossible that this could be an eclipse because it happened during Passover, which is full moon. Therefore, it would be impossible that it could be an eclipse of the sun. So here you have a phenomena of it becoming dark on a clear day at noontime. And it would also have to be a feast day of the Jews. And I don't know of any other day in history when that happened, as Mark has recorded. So let's, though, be generous, and instead of one in 4.29 times 10 to the what fourth power, let's just say that it was a million, one in a million. That's being generous. Verse 34. And it was the ninth hour, that is, after the 3 hours of darkness, when Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. Now, the psalm that we read today begins with those words, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, and interpreted is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? The very words that Jesus cried on the cross were the words of the psalmist. But you say, well, he knew that psalm, and so probably just because he knew it, he cried it. Okay, we'll grant you that. We won't take any chance factors on this. We'll just say that he knew it, and thus he said it. But recognizing that you could say it's a fulfillment of prophecy. But let's go on to verse 36. And one ran and filled a sponge full of vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink, saying, let him alone, let's see whether Elijah will come and take him down. In Psalm 69:21, the psalmist said, they gave me also gall for my meat, and in my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. Now, again, how many men do you think who, when they were thirsty and cried out in thirst, saying, I thirst, someone said, here, drink this, and gave them vinegar? Would you say that 1 in 100,000 would be a fair conservative estimate? Then in verse 43, Joseph, an Arimathean, honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and he went boldly unto Pilate and begged for the body of Jesus. Now Pilate questioned if he had been dead for any time, and he called the centurion and asked him if he had been dead. And when he knew it of the centurion, he gave him the body of Jesus to Joseph. And Joseph bought fine linen and took him down and wrapped him in the linen and laid him in the sepulcher, which was hewn out of a rock, and rolled the stone against the door of the sepulcher. Actually, the other gospels tell us that he was a rich man, and that it was his own sepulcher in which he had buried Jesus. In Isaiah 53:9, and he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence and neither was any deceit in his mouth. And so here he is making his grave with the rich in his death. How many do you suppose that would fit? 1 in 1,000? Verse 24 refers to him being crucified. Now, when a person was crucified, they were nailed to the cross, their hands and their feet. And so in Psalm 22, again, it said, they pierced my hands and my feet. Now, how many men do you know who have had both hands and feet pierced? Maybe you knew someone who had their foot pierced. Most boys step on a nail sometime in their lifetime. But hands and feet pierced. Let's say 1 in 1,000. Now, how could anyone, by accident, fulfill all of these prophecies in just a short span of time, in just a few hours from the time that Jesus was brought before Pilate to the end of the day when he was wrapped by Joseph and placed in the tomb. What are the chances that one man could fulfill all of the predictions that were made of this short space of time? Well, you say, maybe the prophecies weren't really prophecies. Maybe all of these things were written after the fact, and then someone just signed their name and said, I was Isaiah, you know, and wrote it, though, after the fact. Or signed the name David to it and wrote the psalm after the fact. Well, Bible critics do say that this happened. They say that the book of Daniel was written long after Daniel lived. That some unnamed person just wrote the book of Daniel after the events of history had taken place, because Daniel prophesied the dissolution of the Grecian Empire and how it would be divided and the warring factions of those generals that would take over. He described it with such intense accuracy that the Bible critics say, well, he could never have written that before it happened. It was written after, and the guy just signed his name Daniel to it. But it was really spurious. Well, though they might say that concerning Daniel, they would have a rough go saying that concerning David and concerning Amos and concerning Isaiah, because these scriptures were in extent long before Jesus was ever born. Back some 200 years before the birth of Christ, they decided that they needed to translate the Hebrew scriptures into Greek so that the common people could read them, because after the Babylonian captivity, Hebrew was only the language of the scholars, and the common people did not speak Hebrew but had picked up the Greek language after Alexander the Great had come through and introduced the Grecian culture. So they felt, in order that the people can read the scriptures in an understandable language, we need to translate them into Greek. And so 70 Hebrew scholars translated the scriptures into Greek. It was called the Septuagint. And all of these passages are in the Greek translation known as the Septuagint. And we know that that took place 200 years before Christ. So you can't say, well, it was all written after the event. That just doesn't wash. Well, then, maybe knowing the scriptures, Jesus had a great grasp of the scriptures, and knowing the scriptures, maybe he set the whole thing up. He plotted the whole program. And Dr. Schoenfeld has suggested that this is indeed what happened. That he called the book the Passover Plot. And that Jesus, knowing the scripture, just set everything up with very precise exactness. It would be interesting to figure out how he had the sun darkened at noon, wouldn't it? How did you do that one? Like the two fellows who had retired and moved to Miami Beach, sitting on the beach talking with each other, getting acquainted. The one fellow said, well, he said, I used to have a hardware store, but he said we had a fire. Thing was destroyed, so he said, I just collected my insurance and retired here. The other fellow said, well, I had a clothing store and we had a flood, so I just collected the insurance and retired and moved on. He said, a flood? How did you arrange that? So how did you arrange for the sun to go down at noon, you know? And it would be, you'd be hard-pressed to take the high priest who was so antagonistic towards Jesus and work him into the whole plot. To get him to quote that psalm. He trusted in God to deliver him. Let him deliver him now, seeing if have him. You know, to have him quote that, that must have cost a pretty penny. And to have the soldier ready with a sponge full of vinegar when he said, I thirst. That's pretty good planning. In fact, to plan this with such precise detail, you'd almost have to be the Son of God to get it all working together so well. What are the chances that one man could fulfill all of these predictions? Now, as we were going through, we sought to give sort of a chance factor for each of the events, and I thought I was being very conservative. Maybe you don't agree with my conservative, and maybe you figure I'm too liberal, I don't know. But at any rate, at the what I consider very conservative estimates from my own understanding and knowledge of history, in compounding the factors, because that's what you have to do. If there's one in 1,000 here, one in 10,000 here, you have to compound these chance factors. It's known as compound probabilities. You come to there is only one chance in 10 to the 49th power of fulfilling these predictions. In other words, you'd have to have 10 to the 49th power men to find one who fulfilled them all. Now, it is estimated that in our Milky Way galaxy, there are 100 billion stars. Now, I'm sure nobody counted them. I'm sure that's just an estimate. And it's probably based upon some kind of scientific evidence, but no one's really counted them. But they do say that there are probably 100 billion stars in our Milky Way galaxy. I'm sure nobody counted them, because if you wanted to count 100 billion, if you counted it 250 a minute, day and night, it would take you 750 years. So it's very improbable that anybody has ever counted, unless you go back to Methuselah, and maybe he could have done it. But then they say that there are 100 trillion galaxies in our universe. Now, let's say that the 100 trillion galaxies, all of them have at least 100 billion stars. That would mean that you would have 10 to the 23rd power stars in the universe. Now, remember, to fulfill these predictions that we were looking at, 10 to the 49th power, that means that if you had 10 to the 49th power stars, you could start making and filling universes with stars one a second, and you could go on for 10 to the 26th power years making these stars at the rate of one a second. Now, the chance factor of someone fulfilling, or, you know, of you picking out one of the stars of one of these many, many galaxies, and someone else coming along and saying, no, that's my star, I chose that one, is very slim indeed. What does it all mean? When Paul said Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, he said, the gospel that I preach, the good news. It means it doesn't take some kind of incredible faith to believe it. It means that it is actually more credible to believe than not to believe. And so if a person doesn't believe the gospel that Paul preached, it's because the person doesn't want to believe the gospel that Paul preached. But why wouldn't a person want to believe that God loves them? Why wouldn't they want to believe that God loves them so much he sent his son to die for their sins in order that they would not have to suffer the penalty of death because of their sins? Because the scripture said, the soul that sinneth, it shall surely die. The wages of sin is death. Now, the good news is you don't have to die for your sins. Someone else has died for you. God sent his son to die for you. And that God has purposed in his love that if you will just believe that gospel, that Jesus died for your sins, you won't have to die for your sins, but you can have eternal life in the glory of God's eternal kingdom. Now, why would a person not want to believe that? What's so objectionable and horrible about that? You say, oh, not me, man. I don't want any of that stuff. I mean, it really doesn't make sense, does it? The unbelief that people have. You see, when Peter was talking about it, he said, we weren't making up stories. We weren't following cunningly devised fables. When we declared to you the glory of our Lord, we were actually eyewitnesses. But he said, we have the more sure word of prophecy. You may say, oh, you were hallucinating, Peter, you know. He said, but we have something more certain than that. We've got the prophecies. So that if a person doesn't believe, it's just by choice. He doesn't want to believe. And the only reason why I can think that he wouldn't want to believe is that his deeds are evil and he loves what he's doing. And he doesn't want to give up his evil deeds, and thus he refuses to believe. And that's exactly what Jesus said. He said, I didn't come to condemn the world, but to save the world. And he who believes in me is not condemned. But he who doesn't believe in me is already condemned because he hasn't believed in the only begotten Son of the Father. And this is the condemnation. That light has come into the world, but they will not come to the light because they love the darkness rather than the light because their deeds are evil. Do you know that there are many people who are engaged in sinful practices today that they know are killing them and are leading to an early death, but they will not forsake those practices because they love those practices more than they love life. And that's exactly where Jesus said it is. You love the evil more than you love the life that God is offering to you, the eternal life through Jesus Christ. Peter, talking again concerning the death of Jesus, said it was according to the determined counsel and foreknowledge of God. Yes, Christ did die for your sins according to the scriptures. That's the good news. And that is the good news we have to share with you today. As David said in that same Psalm 22 that we referred to so much, that this shall be declared to the generation of the people that shall come, that the Lord has done this. We're declaring to you today, Jesus died for your sins according to the scriptures. And that today you can have eternal life by simply putting your trust in him and believing in him as Savior and receiving him as your Lord. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for this sure word of prophecy, the certainty of the events. And we thank you, Lord, that not only did you promise these things, but you carried them out. And that indeed, Jesus died for our sins according to the Scriptures. And now, Father, we thank you that we have put our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, and that there is therefore now no condemnation, but we have passed from death into the glorious gift of eternal life through Jesus. And that hope. And Lord, we thank you for the joy that we have today, knowing that he died for our sins. And because of that, we have been forgiven and cleansed from our sin. Lord, we pray for those today who have been living in sin, who have not yet come to the light. May this be the day that your Spirit draws them to that place of faith and trust in Jesus. We ask it in his name. Amen. Shall we stand? If you would like to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today, I would encourage you to just go on back to the prayer room, and there pastors and counselors will be waiting to pray with you and to lead you to a faith in Christ. May the Lord be with you, bless you, watch over you, fill you with his love, and give you a glorious week, a fellowship with him, in Jesus' name. The Lord bless thee,
Lord bless thee,
and keep thee.
And keep thee.
The Lord make
his face.
On behalf of the Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact the Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.